Hello and welcome to Endemic Times. My name is Amira. Back in November, I discussed on this channel the effect that school closures had on our nation's children. It was extreme, and data shows that children lost the equivalent of close to a full 2 years of school. School is a critical place for children, not only for education, but also a place of socialization. And sometimes, a lot of times, it is a place of respite from home. Children in the U.S. have been experiencing a mental health crisis that was being discussed and analyzed prior to the pandemic. Sadly, the pandemic catapulted the issue of mental health, or the lack of it, amongst our nation's children. There are many factors that go into the current state of our children's mental health, and this video will provide insight and data, along with some startling realities of this entire situation. It's not just children that are suffering. Adults are also struggling with mental health and access to services. What we are seeing, sadly, is that this inaccessibility to care, the cost of care, and the inability, again, of our government, our political leaders, and our corrupt medical system are all the culprits as to why our mental health is failing and getting worse. So take a breath, hit that like button, and of course subscribe because you know you want to join the Endemic Times fam. Grab a sip, pack a bowl, cuddle a pillow, because we're all struggling, and let's get into it. To better understand our current health situation, let's take a look at this clip.
The National Alliance of Mental Illness says one in five adults experience mental illness every year. And when it comes to children between ages 6 and 17, the stat is one in six. Medical experts say 50% of all lifetime mental illness starts by age 14, 75% kicks in by age 24. NAMI says research suggests genetics, environment, and lifestyle influence all play a role in mental health conditions. Some of those include anxiety, depression, eating disorders, ADHD, and bipolar disorder. There's a range of warning signs to watch for, and each illness has its own symptoms. Some of the common signs of mental illness in adults and children include constant worry or fear, feeling sad, avoiding friends or social activities, changes in eating habits, and substance abuse.
One of the biggest issues happening now is the sheer amount of children that are having to be admitted to the emergency room for mental health because of the lack of care physicians and mental health professionals for children.
In the emergency room at Children's Hospital in Milwaukee, doctors like Michelle Pickett are seeing more kids desperate for mental health help.
We unfortunately see a lot of kids who have attempted suicide. That is something that we see, I'd say, at least once a shift. Yes, unfortunately.
Once a shift, they are seeing an attempted suicide. Once a shift. The kids are not all right. And even more challenging is just the sheer amount of time that kids are having to wait to get help following an ER visit.
Across the country, the average wait time to get an appointment with a therapist is 48 days. And for children, it's often longer.
What does it say to you that the place they have to come is the emergency room?
That there's something wrong with our system. The emergency room should not be the place to go and get, you know, acute mental health care when you're in a crisis. We are not a nice, calm environment.
But they're desperate.
But we're there and we see everybody. But I wish there were more places that kids could go to get the help that they need.
This is a doctor, a medical professional, that is seeing firsthand the gaps, no, more like the gaping holes, in our ability to provide mental health care services to children. It's absolutely heartbreaking, and this is an area of hospital care that, like she said, is not set up for this. It's an emergency room, which means you are going to see and hear a host of extremes. And sadly, many, many children are having to have extended stays in the ER because it's simply all that is available.
How long have the wait lists been to get help?
Normally you're put on, you're scheduled an appointment within a few months.
And then months?
I know, yeah. And then if you want a child psychiatrist, that you're looking at like months to a year.
How important is it to get them help when they need it immediately?
As days go on, the symptoms get worse. If you have a depressed child, you know, maybe they started out where they were feeling depressed. And then as the days goes on, they're suicidal. So it really, you really do need to get that help and that support right away.
Again, another medical professional that sees what needs to be done, but is practically powerless to make a substantial change in any way, simply because of the design of mental health and our healthcare system in general. As I have said numerous times here, healthcare in the US is not about health care. It's about profit. It's about incentives to prescribe, medicate, and medicate some more. Going back to the children that are struggling, the amount of children that are being admitted to ERs is inundating doctors in an area of practice that they are just not equipped to handle, simply because of the design of an ER and how they operate. Yet the amount of children in the ER continues to climb.
To have you, doctors describe some serious challenges dealing with the mental health crisis. They're completely overwhelmed, as I understand it.
Yeah, I mean, what we discovered was that upwards of several thousand to 5,000, if you can believe it, suicidal young people a night spending the night in emergency room department rooms because there are no inpatient treatment beds available. Yeah, I mean, it's a combination of two things. One is the rise in mental health distress, and the other is some structural factors that developed over time where, for good reason, society decided to pull back on inpatient treatment in hopes of keeping people in their homes. But in the meantime, the mental health distress rose. And so those beds weren't available or are not available now that we need them.
What are some of the biggest issues that teens in particular say they're dealing with?
Yeah, they're dealing with anxiety and depression. I mean, if you really want to put a fine point on it, you're looking at a 60% increase in suicides between about 2007 and 2018. To put a fine point on this, we are at a significant inflection point in changing risk among adolescents. It used to be drunk driving, binge drinking, teen pregnancy, cigarette smoking, illicit drugs, all have fallen. Anxiety, depression, self-harm, suicide, all up. Yeah, there are solutions. We haven't yet gotten to these stories. They're coming. But there are a variety of therapies that families that are proven to help, CBT and DBT, dialectical behavioral therapy. They are expensive. They're not easy to find. There is hope. There are medicines to help stabilize. Medicines can also be overused, which is a problem. So in keeping with this idea that we're at inflection point, the system is at an inflection point as well, looking for answers.
There's two parts of this that I want to address. And the first is this, changing risk among adolescents. This is huge and catastrophic when you look at it from afar. So much has changed from when many of us were kids. And there's a lot of reasons and factors that I will get into a little later. But the second thing I want to point to is this last little bit that he mentioned, which is cost. He even says that the treatments are expensive. And that is by far one of the biggest factors we are seeing across the board, not just for children, but also for adults when it comes to the cost of care. When looking at records for more than 28,000 children ages 6 to 17 who were enrolled in Medicaid and had at least one trip to the emergency department between January 2018 and June 2019, it was found that less than a third of the children had the benefit of an outpatient mental health visit within 7 days of being discharged from the ER. A little more than 55% had a follow-up within 30 days. More than a quarter of children had to go back to the ER for additional mental health care within 6 months of their initial visit. There is also a shortage of providers across the board, but especially those of color, which is disproportionately affecting, as so many things do, Black and brown children and adults.
And the shortages aren't just geographical. If you're looking for a provider of color, you may have real trouble, as white people make up 84% of US psychologists, meaning that some patients may have a much harder time finding someone that they can relate to. Like this woman in Philadelphia who began seeing a white therapist but felt that they weren't connecting.
It felt like she just wasn't getting it. And I could tell it was from, you know, the cultural differences. But I felt like I couldn't be myself in the session.
I could imagine particularly white people mm-hmm. hearing that story and thinking, well, but it doesn't matter what color your skin is.
Yes, it does. And it's not necessarily a matter of the color of skin, it's more of the cultural backgrounds. And I was wondering, you know, where are all the Black therapists? Are they hiding underneath a rock?
I wanted a Black male therapist.
Could you find one?
I could not find one for my life.
What's even more heartbreaking is that there are a lot of people that have moved past the common stigma that was formerly placed on people wanting or seeking mental help that do in fact want mental health help, but they just can't get it. And this is something that affects everyone seeking mental health help, regardless of race, ethnicity, identity, living in urban or rural areas. It's affecting everyone.
There have long been wait lists to see a therapist, but it has gotten significantly worse since the pandemic, with 65% of psychologists reporting they had no capacity for new patients. In fact, more than half the people who need mental health care do not receive it, with that rate being even higher for minority populations. Emergency rooms are now becoming overloaded with people, and especially children, who have nowhere else to go, stuck in beds there because there is no space in proper facilities to treat them.
Children having access to mental health services is critical for so many things, but most importantly, it's critical for the health of our nation to have as many stable, well-rounded, critical thinking, and intellectual individuals as possible. We cannot achieve that without mental health care, and we cannot achieve that without providing and striving for major improvements and overhauls in our education system. While Congress allocated $122 billion to support elementary and secondary schools in response to the pandemic through the American Rescue Plan in 2021, including mental health support services, schools reported spending only 15% of that funding during 2021 to 2022 because of delays in accessing the money and staff shortages. Additionally, when funding is used, districts really only spent about 7% of the resources on mental health services. Why aren't there specific parameters and requirements as to how and where this money gets spent? And frankly, how can school administrators with a straight face act like they give a shit about kids when only 7% of the funding specifically for mental health services is going to those services? Where is the money? It's where so much of these disconnects between government and administrators and school boards are so separated from the realities on the ground that it is going to take to improve the lives of our nation's children. Providing better pay for teachers, having mental health professionals that deserve to be paid for their time, and the education for which they have spent copious amounts of money to obtain as required by the position. It's such a disconnect. Because looking at the numbers between 2021 to 2022, the average student to counselor ratio was 408 to 1. The American School Counselor Association has recommended a ratio of 250 to 1 since 1965. So on average, school counselors are providing a myriad of services to children, which is almost double that of the recommended ratio. And even that recommended ratio is insane. How do we expect a school counselor who is likely getting paid an extremely low wage because of shitty administrators that only provide 7% of probably maybe $1 million at least in funding to mental health services of the school? How do we expect them to do a good job? How do we expect our nation's children to feel safe and heard and have someone they can rely on when they don't have that at home? We cannot expect anything other than what we are seeing when every aspect of our government structures does the opposite. Are you mad? I'm outraged. I don't even have kids, but I was a kid who, yeah, needed help and didn't get it. So now here I am on YouTube. You do the math. The pandemic is going to have a major impact on the minds and outlook of the children that were aware during this time. And like so many things in our society, it is those on the outskirts, the already marginalized groups that are and will continue to struggle more than their privileged peers. Looking at Black youth, they lost a primary caregiver at nearly double the rate of white children between March 2020 and November 2021, which has lasting effects on rates of depression, post-traumatic stress disorder, anxiety, and suicide. And about 25% of Black youth reported a parent or adult lost their job during the pandemic. Job losses, money problems, worrying about paying bills and making the rent, having enough food. These are things that kids observe and internalize. And if you've ever seen videos or done research on the scarcity mindset this kind of devastation witnessed at this age is going to set up these children for likely very difficult futures as adults, because they will have a limited money scarcity mindset that brings on stress and fear, and creating that all too often self-fulfilling prophecy of never having enough money. This is something that's real. It's something that I have experienced in my own life because of my own upbringing, and it's a bitch. It's hard to change that part of your brain that is just used to struggle when it's all that it knows. And that struggle is deep rooted and felt through generations. We're close to the end, but I want to show you some of these startling statistics by the CDC. Nearly 3 out of 5 high school girls in the US who were surveyed reported feelings of persistent sadness or hopelessness in 2021, a roughly 60% increase over the past decade. Girls reported high levels of sexual violence, sadness, and suicide risk. 30% reported they seriously considered attempting suicide in 2021, up from 19% in 2011. 29% of high school boys reported experiences of persistent feelings of sadness or hopelessness in 2021, compared with 21% in 2011. Meanwhile, 14% of high school boys reported to have seriously considered attempting suicide, up from 13% in 2011. Girls are particularly vulnerable to anxiety and depression, mental health experts say, given the high rates of harassment and discrimination they face compared with boys. They also face career pressures, high beauty standards, and the expectation of motherhood. 18% of girls in high school said they experienced sexual violence in the past year, compared with 15% in 2017, the first year the CDC began monitoring this trend. 14% of teenage girls reported being forced to have sex when they didn't want to, which is up from 12% in 2011. It's important to keep in mind that the data collected by the CDC is not every child, it's a general swath, which means, sadly, all of these numbers, regardless of gender, are very likely much higher, which should be a huge warning sign. And for me, as a woman who was a high school girl and knows just how difficult that can be, not only do I find these numbers as just a, yeah, that tracks, that it's seemingly getting worse makes me really concerned. And while many don't know the exact reasons for all of this, many have posited that it's because of social media and beauty standards, and I don't disagree with that. But before I get into what I think is happening on a deeper level, let's hear from some of the very girls that are part of these statistics. And phones and iPads, Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and TikTok, these kids were observing and listening and absorbing what adults were discussing, dealing with, and struggling to make do. It was a global pandemic. All makes sense, but it's heartbreaking to see. And as a woman, like I said, that struggled, I get where these girls are coming from. It's hard enough in the best of times to get people to listen and believe what you have to say. But during a pandemic, when now everyone feels like a victim and their victimhood is the most important of all victims, it makes feeling heard and seen for real struggles, real issues, that much more difficult. So why is this happening to girls? Unfortunately, there isn't any clear answer as to why we're seeing what we're seeing. A lot of the theories, like I said, relate to social media influences, cultural influences, as well as just the general tendency of young girls at this age to be going through these kinds of struggles. I think when we look at the impact that everything in our society, especially social media and media culture, there is a lot of pressure being placed on girls. And as a young girl in high school, I know I really struggled with a lot of these things myself. I do think that social media is, unfortunately, playing a really big and debilitating role in how girls feel about themselves, perceive themselves, and when so much content is carefully curated in ways to show wealth and opulence and beauty that is not in everyone's daily life, and it can really separate people, and especially young girls, who are going through a lot just because of our current world issues, on top of real hormonal and biological changes that girls are going through at these ages. There's a lot of questions and doubts and fears, and there's also the dynamic that girls, unfortunately, can just be really mean to each other. I sadly think that there has been a loss of connectedness, and honestly, it has never really been there. I think this trying to find solidarity between women is exceedingly difficult, and I don't think that that has necessarily improved over the last couple of decades. I think that with the influences of social media and media, there has become, for way too long, this mean girl tendency that was really pushed by the media that I know affected my own generation, and I think it's precipitated onto a younger generation that is now absorbing so much of this kind of content from the late millennial era of 90s and aughts movies like Mean Girls that just perpetuated a tendency of girls and women to just not be there for each other. It's not to say this trend isn't changing, but I do think that the non-solidarity that has been way too common amongst women, because on our trajectory and goal of leaning in and being that boss babe bitch, it led us to not supporting each other. It just made us hyper competitive, which women and girls, a lot of them, are already competitive. But the competitive nature that this has led to, coupled with the fact that a lot of girls and women operate in more passive aggressive and manipulative ways. Yeah, ladies, I'm saying it, it's real. I think this is all making it harder on girls and women. I have always been much more direct, and this wasn't received well by a lot of girls. And I've seen that women don't really want to admit the passive, sometimes manipulative methods that are used, and unfortunately that just creates more competition and division amongst ourselves, on top of trying to deal with the rest of the world. I have felt this competition and this inability to have this feeling of solidarity and connectedness with each other, because society is telling us to compete with each other for the jobs, for the body, for the wealth, for the boy. It's exhausting. I'm not saying my way is correct either. I have struggled with all of these and have played my part, I'm sure, in another woman's story. I think we need to take from this that society is pushing everyone, and many are being pushed to their breaking points. That's why I think it's important that we try to lean away from extremes like woke identity politics that has its own agenda, as well as the more extreme conservative rhetoric trying to relegate women back to the home. Neither of these extremes are helping, and I really wouldn't be surprised if this heightened and extremely vocal discourse from both sides is having its effect on young girls as well. The takeaway from all of this is that children are suffering, and if they are to be our future, we need to put aside our differences and do what's best for them. To deal with and heal this situation, we have to come together. It will take all of us, and that's what these kids deserve. As we have seen, our system is not functioning properly. It's broken. The only way that we solve this is through the collective, because we need a multifaceted approach. Our education system needs to be properly funded. Teachers need to be paid more. We need well-trained and compassionate counselors that, like teachers, should be getting paid for their jobs as well. We need a better healthcare system, and all of this truly comes from a completely revamped political system. Ours is not a democracy. Corporate America is our leader right now. We cannot change this overnight, but what we can do is separate our online world and all the hate and division that that creates and take into our daily lives compassion, empathy, and sincerity. We're all struggling, so if you can, take this information as a reminder that we are all human, we're all on a unique journey, and the best way for us to move forward positively is to be there for each other. It can be as simple as opening the door for someone, a kind wave, a simple "I hear you" when a friend or family member is talking about an issue. For so many of us, the simple act of being heard, no solutions, no lectures, just being heard can be huge. Move in kindness. We are being hit from so many angles, and the division overlords want us to be at each other's throats. We cannot let them win. Thank you so much for watching. I hope that you enjoyed this video. If you want to learn more, or if you're a parent and need some resources, please check out the links in the description box below. I did a lot of research on this, so if you need a place to start, I hope that these links will help. If you haven't already, hit that like button, subscribe, hit the notification bell so you get first dibs on when I have more videos out. And as always, please remember to stay safe, take care, and be kind to each other. Burr, butter, butter.